when in the stage of development with Iron Man, or when you were on the set, did you know that this was something that was really going to connect with people in a big way?
Well, it was very late in the process. It was the first film we had done as our own studio. I had been involved, and Marvel had been involved in at certain levels on other films before Iron Man 1, but always as a partner, never as the lead decision maker. The other studios spent the money to make the films. They had the control of the films. And I learned a lot working on other films at other studios, other Marvel films at other studios up to that point. And when we got the chance to do it ourselves, there was a lot of pressure involved because it was all on us. But I was very comfortable with that because if we were to fail, at least we would have failed with the best intentions. And Iron Man 1 being our first film, we really believed in Tony Stark. We really believed in having a character that was as interesting, if not more interesting, outside of the costume as he was in the costume. And, you know, Marvel Studios' Iron Man, would be the marquee name, allowed us to say, let's just cast the best actor we can find. And it's funny to remember now, Robert Downey Jr. is the biggest star on the planet. What he was then was one of the best actors on the planet, not necessarily one of the biggest marquee stars on the planet. And it was liberating to make decisions like that that I don't know would have been made at other studios at the time. And saying, we believe he's the best. He might not be a marquee name, but let's go with him. And Jon Favreau, who had done Elf, which is a classic and has only grown since then, not a giant visual effect, blockbuster, enormous scale film. But what Jon brought to the process and what Robert brought to the process as we were working together to make Iron Man 1 laid the foundations, not only with the narrative and the story for where we've gone, now almost 19 films with Infinity War, but also the tonality of our films and behind the scenes, the way we made the films. Jon set up a lot of process, and together we discovered a lot of techniques of collaboration that we've kept on all of our films, all going back to Iron Man 1. And it really wasn't until the near final screenings of the films for our distribution studio at the time where people started to say, this is something special. When at that time, we were just saying, are we going to be able to finish it on time? Are we going to be able to make it?
Do you remember a particular screening or a comment from an audience member that clicked with you and you thought, wow, this is actually special? And
we do what we call friends and family screenings on all of our films, made up of neither friends nor family, but made up of people that we trust to tell us the truth and to not tell anybody else about the horrifically rough version of the movie that we're showing them at that point. So we take notes and take ideas and learn from every screening we do. On those early Iron Man screenings, it was apparent that that audiences loved Tony Stark, that audiences loved the redemption arc that Tony was undergoing in that first movie. And it was after those screenings and again some of the executives at the studio at the time that started making very big predictions for the opening weekend. And at that point, we weren't thinking about opening. The only thing we were thinking about, and even think about to this day, because it's the only thing we can control, is how will the audience respond on opening weekend? It's not about the numbers. It's not about, you know, the tracking. Other people can worry about that later in the process. We work on how will the audience respond on opening weekend.
One of the things about Tony Stark and Captain America, and these characters feel very grounded in a real world and in a world that speaks to the times. Was that a real conscious decision to ground these films in something that felt like it was the world that was outside of the cinema as well?
One of the amazing things about the Marvel comics is that they reflect the time period in which they were created. They reflect the time period in which they were written. I think some of that was conscious and some of that was unconscious at the time. I think it's the exact same thing with us at Marvel Studios now. We're all a product of our time. I don't think we set out to make any overt political statements in our movies, but we're influenced by the world around us as we're sitting in a room developing the stories and creating the stories. Sometimes they can match up much more directly than we were even planning. When we were working on the second Captain America film, we knew we wanted to change up the genre. The first Captain America film was a great ode to World War II films. We wanted this one to be more of a political thriller because we wanted to put, as he had been put in comics in the past, Steve Rogers in a position where he wasn't sure who he was working for. That was one of the most interesting things to us about Steve Rogers, is putting him in a moral quandary. So we came up with this idea, spoiler alert, that S.H.I.E.L.D. was Hydra. That Hydra had remained within S.H.I.E.L.D. and that he would have to choose to bring it down. And one of the things Hydra was doing was mass surveillance of the public, to determine threats before they happen. As we were, I want to say, midway through production on that film, there were news stories in real life that applied directly to that. Not about Hydra, but about surveillance. And when we went on the press junket, people asked us, how did you know, the Edward Snowden thing clearly influence this? And we said, well, we wrote it before we knew anything about that. But it is fun to ground these characters, to keep them as relatable as possible to our audience, while still maintaining the fact that Tony Stark is a genius that builds an iron suit that can fly around, and Steve Rogers was frozen in ice for decades, and Thor comes from another planet. But all of them are human and have flaws and have characteristics that we can see ourselves in on that stage.
I think that's particularly true of Hulk, because it's about controlling your anger, obviously. Right. That was the second film, and not the sort of huge breakout success of some of the other characters as an individual film. Mm-hmm. Why do you think that was?
I think with The Incredible Hulk, we were trying to bring a Bruce Banner and a Hulk into the beginnings of our MCU, into the beginnings of the cinematic universe. And obviously Tony Stark showing up at the end to see William Hurt, who is continued in our other movies, because that film is canon and that is part of our MCU storylines. The thing about Hulk, and we realized this early on as we started working on the Avengers, that he's a great character who I do think can have standalone movies, and I think would be great in his own standalone movies. There's a wish fulfillment to Hulk that even the worst of us can be used for good, that I think is why that character has endured for as many years as it has. But there's also something fun that had never been explored on screen before in either the two movies or in his television series, which when he's this unpredictable part of this ensemble, you know, is what was most interesting to us. And then putting him in Ragnarok last year to provide a whole different grouping and totally take him out of his element.
So will we get a Hulk individual film anytime soon?
Not anytime soon.
Okay. By Captain America, we meet Agent Carter, and she's one of the strong female characters that I think people forget were really introduced early into the yes. MCU. Obviously, Black Widow, Betty Ross, all these other characters. Can you talk about the evolution of those female characters?
From the beginning of my career, the notion of the damsel in distress was outdated. And when we started making our own movies, we didn't want to fall into that trope. And with Agent Carter, she is unbelievably capable at a time when it was very difficult for women to rise up the ranks in the military. And we really wanted to create these female characters that were as strong and as capable as the heroes. Now, as we've continued to grow, that's gotten even more apparent, to the point where they are the heroes. And for us, that is what is unbelievably important. The comics have been doing that well for years. Evangeline Lilly has already finished her role as the Wasp in Ant-Man and the Wasp. It'll only grow from there. And as you mentioned, what Ryan Coogler did with Okoye and Nakia and Shuri in Black Panther, they're already iconic characters, and people already ask, when are they getting their movies? When do we get to see the Shuri movie? And the answer is, nobody wants to see that more than me. And that's a testament to that film and to those actresses and to the world being ready and being overdue to see these type of characters on the screen.
And obviously the phase one kind of climaxes with the Avengers. It was a kind of genius stroke to bring Joss on board, given what he'd done. But he wasn't an obvious choice in some ways. He'd written about assemblages of characters,
right,
but not necessarily directed something of this scale and
right.
scope. Why was he the right man?
Early on, we realized that the role of the filmmaker on our films is to bring a tonality. Jon Favreau, amazing job. Bring a unique tonality and be able to maintain and ride that tone, to bring the characters to life, to make them realistic, grounded, as we were talking about earlier. And that we have amazing artists and technicians that can help with the scale, that can help with as big a canvas as it is. But what the filmmakers need to do is to sort of not get lost in all of that and focus on the great character work. And the big danger of the first Avengers was just getting overwhelmed with action. So many superheroes, so much spectacle, so many visual effects. And we knew there'd be plenty of that. But the most interesting thing about the Avengers is, why in the world are all these people in the same room together? And what would they do when they're in the same room together? And Joss Whedon was an amazing writer and had done amazing things, the entire Buffy series. He had written X-Men comics that showed that the character would not get lost amongst the spectacle. He, of course, exceeded all of our wildest expectations twice.
speaking of the spectacle, I guess if you're going to single out a moment in the Avengers that really captures, it's the shot of the Avengers assembling it, yes, in the Battle of New York. Can you tell me a little bit, were you on set that day? How did that moment
happen? That shot was the shot of all the Avengers assembling for the first time was filmed in an open-air warehouse in New Mexico. There was nothing but green screen behind them. Iron Man wasn't in the shot. Hulk wasn't in the shot because they were CG and put in later. But it looked pretty cool. And Joss had a great vision for it. Cut to many months later, the visual effects are coming together. It's starting to look cool. Iron Man's there now landing. Hulk is there. But the moment when I realized that this could be an iconic moment, not just for the MCU, but for these kind of films, was on the mix stage. When the effects were final and when Alan Silvestri's amazing score was coming in, and the timing and the experience of watching the whole movie up to that point. When you just watch the dailies, when you just watch the visual effects shots coming in, you don't get the experience of watching that final playback on the mix stage with Silvestri's amazing score put in, building to that moment, that I got chills. And I realized Joss had pulled it off.